So this is the idea. I brought some ideas and questions to work with you. I'd like to, if possible, leave plenty of time to comment, questions, and exchange. I'm going through a topic that is not easy, and I would hate that jargon becomes a wall between us. So I'm going to try to explain every term to the minimum detail, and I would ask you please to interrupt me if there is something that is not clear. In doing so, I will have a small time to talk about Lacan, and then from there, we will talk about the other subjects. So,
Marcel, I started recording you with this camera, so if that one doesn't work, we got you.
Great. I got two.
Great.
So, music, sex, and the sublime. When I talk to you about music, I am not referring to the academic term, but to a discipline that is deeply rooted in human culture. Something like Claude Lévi-Strauss defined as the supreme mystery of the science of man. A mystery that all the various disciplines come up against and which holds the key to their progress. When I talk about sex, rather than the common conception, I will be talking as forces that define our subjectivity, and our subjectivity not in a broad sense, but closely related to the notion of the subject in Lacanian clinic. With Lacan, we have the sexuality as the core of human life. It is rather a mode of existence of the sexuality in the human, beyond its purely biological dimension. Human sexual life is not to language. Sexuality is not a relationship with the other sex, but on the contrary, compared to the animal, there is a central lack in human sexuality. Finally, when we talk about the sublime, instead of talking about the philosophical conception, I would slide the signifier chain and we will talk about sublimation, which is the way that the sublime is investigating Lacanian theory. The subject of Lacan is the subject of the unconscious. Rather than being an imaginary place in which we have the concept that it contains wild drives that have to be domesticated by the ego, it is the site where a traumatic truth speaks out. It's not a deep existential truth, but an unbearable truth that we have to learn to live with. Do you hear me okay? I hear a return of music. Lacan differs greatly from other psychoanalytic schools. Psychoanalysis is, with him, is not just a technique, but a clinic that confronts the subject with the most radical dimension of human existence. Mental illnesses or structures such as neurosis, psychosis, perversions, have the dignity of fundamental philosophical attitudes towards reality. When somebody suffers from obsessional neurosis, this condition draws or entails an entire conception of reality, defining the global structure of the personality. Is there any term that is not clear or anything is coming along? When we talk about the subject in Lacan, you will see this type of writing. If the subject can be represented as an S, the subject of the unconscious, you will see like an S bar. Because there is a part of us that we don't know about it. And that ignorance, that in the history of philosophy, if you go to Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, and you will find that as the Dionysian side. It will be the part that is veiled from the Apollonian ego that believes is in control. in Lacan terms, subject is a divide. Lacan is famous for his statement that our unconscious is a structure like a language. He took that from initially the Saussure linguistics. For Saussure, for example, a sign is not necessarily something that connects a word or a name to a thing, but in fact is something which connects a sound to a concept. So with Saussure, we have the signifier over the signifier. Signifier would be the sound, phonetic sound. Signifier would be the concept. Lacan, clinic, invert that. In Lacan, we will see that the signifier takes place up, and the signifier is down. Lacan definition is that the signifier is what represents a subject to another signifier. Or you can change, I repeat, a signifier is what represents a subject to another signifier. You can change that formula and say the subject is what represents a signifier to another signifier, which means the meaning is lost. The meaning is repressed. The signifier is never reached. So slide from signifier to signifier. Lacan developed his teachings in three human registers. The imaginary, which I refer you to the basis for that, is in the mirror stage, that you can search on that and how we constitute our identity, which is alienated because we constitute that coming from the other. And that goes in our lives, repeating itself many times, defining what we call our identity, which is an illusion. The symbolic register is usually associated with a structure. It's not the same as language, because language would be the structure that involves the imaginary, the symbolic, which is the law and structures, and also the last one, which is the real. The real, if we can differentiate words in the symbolic world, the real is undifferentiated. The real is the impossible. The resistance to symbolization is why the real is essentially traumatic. So we have three registers in which we define our clinic, and also for Lacan, human existence. So far, okay? Please, we can ask me. It's a good moment because I'm going to go around things and to have definitions. So we have subject, we have the registers, we have the idea that it's a divide subject. Now let's go to the topic. I play music for you. So music will be implied. Sex is already implied because sex is part of the human condition of access to language. So, when to discuss the sublime, I thought to ask two questions. Why music affects us so profoundly? Why music like Bach, Prelude, to name an example, you can have your music, engage us so emotionally that all of a sudden, while listening or performing, we might think, what is happening to me? Why I have the sensation of going to another world? And the second question, to go along with coordinates, is what is the enjoyment of music? Could music making be the equivalent of sexual pleasure? Tricky one, two questions. The first one, I claim that the musical subject, which I name the musicant subject, experience, among other things, a process of sublimation. Sublime change into sublimation. Few concepts of psychoanalysis have had such relevance in the art as the concept of sublimation. Sublimation comes from the Latin limitare and limits. It means domain, definition of boundaries, can refer to the boundaries of the body. Limis means detour. From there, the word comes sub. Sublimis. Sublime and sublimation share the same root. It's almost a contradiction. Something that comes from the boundaries of the body and is associated to something that becomes elevated. Sublimation takes us to the skies, but apparently it's on the boundaries of the body. What is the pleasure of music? Jacques Miller, which is the editor of Lacan's work and his nephew, his son-in-law, says it would be very easy to say that sublimation involves repression, but Lacan emphasized that is precisely why the term does not mean. The concept of sublimation indicates that there is no sexual activity, nor is there repression. It's the paradox of satisfaction of the drive without sexual activity and repression. And I go now to the topic today. I'm going to give you just through to your formula, and we're going to talk about this formula and finish and discuss. If it sounds good, please.
Can you repeat the paradox sentence, the paradox of the...
We are talking about sublimation, and it's the paradox or satisfaction of a drive without sexual activity and without repression. Because you know that all the drives, they stop at the repression. So apparently that would be one way, a solution of happiness, that we call it sublimation, if I can prove logically in Lacan theory. Lacan theory is a theory of logic. It's not empiric. The formula goes like this. Lacan says, in seminar 7, sublimation raises an object to the dignity of the thing, with capital T. You're familiar with the thing, the Kantian thing, the impossible to achieve, the Freudian thing, something which is beyond words, beyond names, something that we can never reach. In 2 years ago in Austin, I presented sublimation and the body. You can see in YouTube, and I on that lecture, I discuss in detail the thing. But today I'm going to suggest another direction. Sublimation is one of the possible destinies of the drive, and according to the definition, is asymptomatic, without repression. So, the direction I suggest tonight is to question the primacy of the signifier in the process of sublimation, while understanding that human life, the speaking being, lives in the terrain of the signifier. Do you see the paradox? We have to go to the logic of Heraclitus, not Aristotle. We have to go to the logic of both things opposite being true at the same time. It's quite clear in the clinic that it's a technique based on the subject to signifiers. Lacan described the repression using two methods, the metaphor and the metonymy. Do I pronounce it right? Metonymy. Those are the words indicating the process under which we can change the word for another word, or we can slide in a change. We never reach the meaning. Let me give you an example. A patient comes and says, well, Uncle Billy is the idiot of the family. What does it mean, the idiot? It means his capability to think is not good. It means that the family he has a family business, as he's the only one not profiting from it. It's because he ran away. It's because he's whatever. We don't know the word, the meaning will slide over signifier and signifier. But in the Seminary 7, Lacan says that the metonym is the displacement of the signifier, is the mechanism by excellence of the censorship. And with respect to the metaphor, the condensation is the other method under which repression acts. Today, I'm going to claim to you that the thesis is that to understand sublimation, we should think the concept associated with the distortion of the drive, the Entstellung, the distortion of the drive. And Lacan make a reference of that as the economy of sublimation. In Lacan terms, quotation, it is in the sliding of the signifier over signified that repression acts via the metaphor and the metonym. In this way, we can think and highlight the difference between sublimation and the return of the repressed, known as a symptom. Another quote from Lacan. Without taking into account the signifier function, it's impossible to distinguish between the return of the repressed from sublimation as one possible way of satisfaction of the drive. End of quotation. Lacan considers that it's in the opportunity of change of object where the repression situates. Lacan's approach is quite remarkable. His formula, the one I said before, I repeated. Sublimation is what raised an object to the dignity of the thing. Sublimation is what takes an object and raises it to the dignity of the thing. And Lacan's approach is remarkable, his solution. He says, the formula understands that sublimation avoids repression, taking the process of changing itself, rather than a slide, is the change in itself taken as an object. Lacan says in his, again, quotation, only one thing considers the possibility of satisfaction of the tendency and is the notion of sublimation. Sublimation is the tendency of changing objects without repression. Is the change in itself, is not the metonym or the metaphor. The Entstellung would be the word distortion.
In that statement, what does object mean?
Object means pursuit of a longing or what we can call desire that is never reached. I want to have a girlfriend, I would like to have a house, and then I have a car, and then the process of desire never ends. And usually, desire is associated with satisfaction. And the opposite of that would be the unlimited enjoyment, which we use the French word jouissance, because it involves two concepts, the pleasure and pain at the same time. The word jouissance involves the concept of pleasure and pain. Sorry?
Can you write the word down?
Certainly. With the mind, you see, the object is always lost.
No, but I have another one. The word we define pleasure in Lacanian terms is jouissance. Jouissance, even Lacan plays with words many times. You can see here, je, oui, sens. I hear meaning in French. But the word jouissance is the word for pleasure that involves satisfaction and pain. Very applicable to any endeavor, human endeavor. So, what is here at stake is the change itself.
By doing that, avoids repression, because one possible destiny of the signifier is the metonymic change of the lost object. Another thing is to take the tendency to change the object as an object. In other words, it's not about taking a signifier as representing some object to another signifier, but taking the signifier at itself, elevating it to the dignity of the thing. Is this a way of rejecting the primacy of the signifier? Yes and no, because we experience sublimation as a limit of the signifier, but within the structure of dealing with signifier. When a work of art, a musical work, creates a suspension, a passion in us, delaying the function of the signifier, we are considering that object the thing. Lacan said that music and all art exist, quotation, when the status of the object eludes the capture by the signifier. Remembering court love? The court love, Lacan refers that as one example of sublimation. The woman, those poems, incredible, so beautiful, so the guy never reached the woman. The woman, the poem is so sublimated, it's so elevated that he never touched it. The object becomes impossible. There is an Argentinian French psychoanalyst, Juan David Nacio, you can refer. He wrote a book on art, the object of an art. And he considers that the work of art has two major effects on the listener. It hypnotizes him or her and recreates the same state of passion that the artist felt. I disagree with both accounts, as I think that music or art awakens, not hypnotizes, awakens to a different subjective mode of living, momentarily. It's not the daily life state. That's the first one. And regarding to the second, I disagree. We can feel the same passion of the artist, because an individual has this structure that is absolutely different from individual to individual, from subject to subject. But I would say that music transmits a signifier without signifying, and does not require time to translate its meaning. This point is the fundamental difference between a word and a music note. I repeat, music transmits a signifier without signifier, and does not require time to translate. The impact, it's there in your chest, or you move because of rhythm, or start crying because it's sad, or jumping because it's happy. The impact of music is related to sublimation, although sublimation does not entirely explain our relationship with the object music. Feeling like going to another world is related to the process of sublimation. To sublimate is not the metonymic change from object to object, represented by a signifier to another signifier, but an object raised to the status of the thing. I apologize for saying that 7-10 times. The thing found in a phrase, a melody, musical structure, a gesture, a dance movement, a paint, is elevated to the thing. Could making music be the equivalent of sexual pleasure? I don't know. I guess for some. Argentinian writer Cortázar said that opening a book for him was like opening a box of chocolates or getting in bed with a much desired woman. And Leonard Bernstein used to say that he had orgasm while conducting. And one of the reasons I came here was to study with one Rostropovich student that was in cello, that's my legacy. And my teacher used to say that listening to this pianist, Pletnev, made him go to a state similar to orgasm. I don't know. So, Lacan defined art as the development around the void, because the subject, by being, it has a hole in itself, which is a void. Thinking about sublimation has many implications. To provide the object with the dignity of the thing is not something that can be operated by the ego. It's not an operation that involves work, effort, something conscious, but a condition of subjective process, which goes simultaneously with a certain subjective position, which in the case of music, I name it the musicant.